Accused of murder, accused of rioting, accused of rape. Over 30% of our lawmakers face serious criminal charges. And now the Supreme Court has put the onus on the Parliament to frame laws deciding whether lawmakers facing criminal charges should be barred from contesting elections.
The onus has been placed on Parliament, but the seriousness with which Parliament will take these instructions and really go on to enact a statute, if that were to happen, is the big question.
Supreme Court ne hamari maang ko jaiz mante hue Parliament ko bola hai, aap ek kanun banaiye jisse rajniti ka apradhikaran aur rajniti ka bhrashtachar roka ja sake.
Now Netas cutting across party lines have united to hail the Supreme Court's verdict.
The candidate, when he wants a ticket, should explain whether he has any criminal charges.
It's a very balanced and reserved judgment coming from the Supreme Court.
But the big question is, will our lawmakers make a law to purge their own?
We are all agreed that we don't want criminals. Lawbreakers will be our lawmakers. But it's the Parliament, or the Chief Justice has emphasized it. I think it's the Parliament to make the laws. The court can't legislate in that respect.
As the nation marches towards a new India, Mirror Now asks, how do we decriminalize politics? Let's debate.
Good evening. Political parties are quick to demand resignation of a rival politician when an allegation of a serious crime is made. They demand that XYZ must be sacked, must be suspended, must be thrown out of the party. But why is it then that over one third of our MPs and MLAs have criminal cases going on against them, but no political party thinks twice about that or even demands their resignation? Today, the Supreme Court said, viewers, that it cannot take the decision, that some things should be left to the Parliament, and that the Parliament must definitely look at bringing in a law. But the Supreme Court also made it clear that those who are contesting elections must reveal all the details, must make all the details public. That there should be efforts undertaken by political parties and even election commission to, on a widespread basis, tell you, the voter, whether your contestant has a serious crime charge against them. How many cases are there? What are the allegations? At what stage is that trial? All of those details will now have to be made public. But the big question that we are asking tonight is it okay to have a murder accused, to have a rape accused, a riot accused, an extortion and kidnapping accused as our lawmaker or even our legislator? In a country where the government in power talks about Swachh Bharat non-stop, why doesn't it want Swachh politics? Who will decriminalize our politics is the big question tonight. But before I go across to our panelists, joining me right now is BJP leader and a renowned lawyer, Mr. Nalin Kohli. Thank you so much, Mr. Kohli, for joining us. What's your view? Should the Parliament make such a law? The onus has been put on the Parliament. Supreme Court is not going to decide. But do you think, Mr. Kohli, it is high time that we do this?
Well, certainly any move towards decriminalization of politics is important, because at the end of the day, it is to do about strengthening democracy and the democratic process. I think we need to decode it in a few from a few perspectives, and particularly the legal perspective. I think the Honorable Supreme Court, in its judgment, has made it clear that it respects what is part of the basic structure of the Constitution, which is the separation of powers, that it is not going to encroach into the area which is Parliament, or it is the legislative duty, since those laws have to be made by Parliament. But at the same time, the Supreme Court has also flagged the importance of the matter in terms of the recommendations that it has made to the Election Commission in particular, in terms of getting out the information to the public, larger public at large, or into the public domain, about those who are having criminal antecedents, and putting it out there prominently, and expecting political parties also to have knowledge and spread that information. So therefore, in crux, I would say, in conclusion, it's a good step in the right direction. That decriminalization has to take place. The BJP, among other political parties, has brought this issue up in the past. I think working on black money and stopping its use is an important step in that direction. Additionally, in terms of one nation, one poll, that is another aspect of seeing how do you cut down on electoral expenses. But I think it will be to the collective wisdom of Parliament, and certainly Parliament would need to look at what it needs to do in this context to protect the rights of those who are innocent and may be facing false cases, and ensuring that the guilty are not allowed to participate.
But then what is the middle path, Mr. Kohli? For, especially when it comes to for serious crimes and heinous crimes, surely we cannot have such people who are facing these charges in the parliament while that trial is going on.
That's a dangerous trend, because criminal jurisprudence in effect, Tanvi, is you are innocent unless proven guilty. The exception to this rule is only where the statute specifically provides that you are guilty unless proven innocent. Now, those are exceptional special statutes. But generally, if the presumption of innocence is there, charge sheet is not presumption of guilt. Charge sheet means that there is something preliminary, and now the court will decide whether it will stand the scrutiny of the legal process in terms of evidence, in terms of the prosecution case, etc. Now imagine a scene, hypothetically, someone is charge sheeted for murder and after 8 years or 7 years or 6 years is pronounced innocent. Now, in effect, what has happened is if you at an initial stage are holding them guilty and preventing them from contesting in the case of a politician, and 8 years later they are proved innocent, then what do you do? In that case, you have actually held them guilty, and there might be a whole move to ensure that charge sheets are filed without it necessarily borne by evidence. So it's a tough call. We'll have to look at how it comes of it. And a lot more thought will need to go into this. That is it to be at the charge sheet stage or a faster trial, getting special courts to do so. These are possible steps, but it's difficult to say without Parliament applying its mind to it, what should be done, which would ensure democracy is protected. The guilty are not allowed to do there, but an innocent does not suffer either.
So how do we protect the citizen then? Tomorrow a murderer could get elected to a position of power and then misuse that position of power to even derail the investigation.
See, Tanvi, unfortunately, being a lawyer, we see both sides. From that perspective, why I use unfortunately, laws are always made for protecting the innocent and ensuring that the guilty go. But the inadequacies of the structure sometimes ensure that even the innocent get ensnared into the net of false cases. It could be as simple as in a matrimonial dispute. It could be as heinous as rape. Now, let's first segregate it. Rape or murder, these are heinous crimes. They are terrible crimes, and there's no question of a guilty person having any kind of leniency. But on the other hand, there have been also cases where the courts are now calling them, those who have survived a false or a malicious rape case, a charge on them, or even in a dowry case. So that's the other side of the story. So when you say about protecting the citizen, I think in today's judgment, the Honorable Supreme Court, by saying we need to put it out in the public domain, and an informed citizen is critical to a healthy democracy. So in some senses, we are moving in that direction. But how do we, to me personally, I think fastest trials, separate courts might be a solution. Because if you can reduce that whole period of trial and bring it down to, say, a shorter period, then, it might be something that, you would know within a finite period whether somebody is guilty or innocent. And once there is a conviction, in any case, those bars have fallen in place through electoral law.
And I know you have to leave, Mr. Kohli, but thank you so much for joining us here on the Urban Debate and sharing your views. Let's go across to our panelists now. Professor Jagdeep Chokar, founder for Association of Democratic Reforms, joining us this evening. I also have Kailash Vasudev, senior advocate with the Supreme Court, Adil Singh Boparai, spokesperson for the Congress Party. And first up, we'll go across to Ashwini Upadhyay, who was the petitioner in this case. And Mr. Upadhyay, the Supreme Court, while agreeing that there must be some way of, stopping people with serious criminal charges in the parliament, has decided to not take that step themselves. What are our options now as citizens? How do we decriminalize politics?
देखिए ये सुप्रीम कोर्ट का ये फैसला और अच्छा हो सकता था अगर सुप्रीम कोर्ट ने सीधे सीधे जिन लोगों के खिलाफ गंभीर मामलों में अपराध है अगर उनको रोक दिया होता, लेकिन सुप्रीम कोर्ट ने वो नहीं किया। हालांकि इसके पहले बहुत सारे मामले में कर चुके हैं, विशाखा का मामला है, बहुत सारे ऐसे मामले हैं जब जहाँ जहाँ पर गैप मिला है, जहाँ जहाँ वैक्यूम मिला है, वहाँ सुप्रीम कोर्ट ने उसको फिलअप किया है। इस मामले में नहीं किया है और पार्लियामेंट को बोला है। पहली बात तो ये कि जो हमारी प्रेयर थी, जो हमारी डिमांड थी कि जिसके खिलाफ चार्जेस फ्रेम हो गया है सीरियस केसेस में, उसको बाहर कर दिया जाए, उसको चुनाव लड़ने से रोक दिया जाए, वो हमारी डिमांड को उन्होंने रिजेक्ट नहीं किया बल्कि एक्सेप्ट किया, उस पर अपना स्टैंप लगाया और हमारी मांग को जायज बताया और बहुत जरूरी बताया। अब बात है कि उसको आगे क्या, ट्रिपल तलाक के केस में सुप्रीम कोर्ट ने कहा था ट्रिपल तलाक इज इलीगल बट पार्लियामेंट विल मेक ए लॉ। हमारे केस में बोला योर डिमांड इज वेरी लीगल, योर डिमांड इज वेरी राइट बट पार्लियामेंट विल मेक ए लॉ। अब हमारा यही कहना है कि जब सुप्रीम कोर्ट के कहने पे पार्लियामेंट पे ऑर्डिनेंस आ सकता है, ट्रिपल तलाक को बैन करने के लिए ऑर्डिनेंस आ सकता है, तो मुझे लगता है इसके लिए भी केंद्र सरकार जरूर इस पर कानून लाएगी। कानून बनाने में दिक्कत है तो एटलीस्ट इमीडिएटली इस पर एक ऑर्डिनेंस लाया जा सकता है और जो अभी आने वाले इलेक्शन है विधानसभा के और लोकसभा के, उसमें तत्काल ऐसे लोगों को चुनाव लड़ने पर रोक देना चाहिए।
आपको बहुत ज़्यादा उम्मीद है, मुझे तो बिल्कुल नहीं है, क्योंकि ट्रिपल तलाक का मामला चाहे अलग हो, लेकिन ये तो ऐसा केस है उपाध्याय जी जहाँ पे वो खुद के बारे में डिसीजन ले रहे हैं, उन्हीं के दोस्त हैं, उन्हीं के पार्टी के लोग हैं जो कल पार्लियामेंट से या असेंबली से बाहर हो सकते हैं। तो इतना डिसिप्लिन और सेल्फ रेगुलेशन तो हमारी पॉलिटिकल पार्टीज में है नहीं, पर चलिए अगर आपको उम्मीद है तो देखते हैं आगे क्या होता है। बट जो आपने दूसरा पॉइंट उठाया, आई विल टेक दैट पॉइंट अक्रॉस टू मिस्टर कैलाश वास्तव। मिस्टर कैलाश वास्तव, व्हाइल द debate over to what extent should judiciary take some decisions and what decisions should be left to the parliament and the legislature, that debate will go on. But there is merit in the argument that in many cases judiciary has taken decisions. It chose not to do so in this specific case.
Good evening. It's not only in this case, but in many a case, the Supreme Court has issued a request, or rather made a request to Parliament to frame laws. I can name a dozen. Essentially, in the matter where you are relating to electoral reforms, seeking amendments of a vast nature to the Representation of People Act 1950-51, you're seeking directions to the Election Commission to carry out changes. Now, these are not domains which come within the domain of the Supreme Court. Supreme Court, under the doctrine of separation of powers, maintains its own positions. It has considered the plea of the petitioners. It has heard the government. It has expressed anguish that people with criminal antecedents are coming into politics. They say that till a charge is framed, a person can contest. Post-charge, you'll have to consider. A suggestion has been given to Parliament that, look, this is not our jurisdiction, and rightly so. You please frame the law. We will make sure that the law is implemented, because law framing is not in the jurisdictions of the Supreme Court. They are not a legislative body. At this point of time, I have not read the whole judgment. I just sort of scanned through bits and bobs of it before this program. Personally speaking, it is a wake-up call on the moral side to all political parties that don't do this. It's not in the larger interest of the nation. Before a law comes into action, it is time for the political parties to wake up to realize that cleaning up of the decriminalization of the political system has become the order of the day. You have got today a vote bank which is massive in the form of youngsters, people under 30. If you're not going to lay down proper precepts and perspectives, it is the political parties who will suffer in the long run. I'm drawing two distinct parallels because Parliament will carry out its functions as and when the occasion comes. God knows whether they will do it now, wait for 2019 election to be over, because they've got to choose people from all walks of life, including those who are vote carriers at the cost of the gun. This is where the problem is going to be. We'll have to wait for 2019 because I don't see any political party inclined to change the system before this election. Changes will come post-election, and that is where the crux of the question is, how do you implement it? Implement it by political parties choosing clean candidates, not choosing those people who have got cases against them. How far, how much, that is to be seen. But the Supreme Court has not erred in passing this jurisdiction onto the Parliament, because this is not Supreme Court's jurisdiction to frame laws. They pointed out what is wrong, so correct it.
Yeah, and I must point out that while they have passed on the responsibility to
Supreme
the Parliament,
Court has generous.
Yes, they have done it with a very strong message along with it, because the Supreme Court says that that they recommend to the Parliament to bring out a strong law, that the citizens cannot stand as silent, mute and deaf spectators to corruption. And they have, of course, what they could have done, they have gone ahead and said that we must ensure that there is widespread publication of the details of the criminal records, pending cases, what kind of cases of each and every contestant. And that onus now is on political parties.
No, you see, can you see in the judgment, they say that when you fill up your nomination, when you have nomination, you have to mention in capital letters the offence against which you are, cases which are pending against you. You've got to give the details of the status of the cases. And you must make it public and make everybody aware that this candidate has got this kind of a case pending against him. You see, in itself, that is a very powerful statement to tell a person who's standing for election. The gentleman, disclose yourself. If you don't disclose yourself, you have more trouble coming your way. But a criminal coming into politics, declaring his status to be a criminal, will become very difficult for the voter to accept. So indirectly, the Supreme Court has made a very powerful move in informing the voter that, look, the candidate who's coming up is either clear or he's unclean. That impact is there in the whole judgment, notwithstanding the fact that Parliament will legislate. When it legislates, it legislates. But at the moment, this is legislation by the court. Please come clean, inform the voter what your position is a good enough message to everybody as to what the candidate is. This in itself is law by itself.
Yes. So, let me ask the question to Mr. Boparai, then, of the Congress Party. Will you take the lead here? Make all these details public right away and keep such people out of politics or elections until the cases are over, Mr. Boparai?
Well, Tanvi, first and foremost, the Congress Party welcomes the judgment of the Honorable Supreme Court. We concur with the Supreme Court that it's time that we cleanse our political stream of any kind of criminal elements. I think it is incumbent on us, we owe a responsibility to the voters to ensure that clean people enter politics and hold offices of profit and discharge constitutional duties. This is point number one. Point number two, the Honourable Congress President, way back in 2013, and I would like to jog your memory to 2013, had publicly repudiated an ordinance to protect convicted MPs and MLAs. He had publicly repudiated it. So we sincerely stand for decriminalization of Indian politics. This is point number two. Point number three, you have to draw a classification here. There is a category of cases which are politically motivated and which are lodged or foisted on political opponents, which flow out of vengeance or vendetta. This is one category of cases. And the second category is, of course, of heinous offences. So I think we must be mindful of this classification, because in Indian politics, it is a reality that political opponents do indeed foist false cases.
How do you do that? How can you do
it
at the stage level
until we get
the verdict?
You have to discern the nature of cases.
So if there is a false murder case and a rape case, how will you decide that?
The fact of the matter is there are multiple.
If there is a riot accused, which category does he fall into?
The point is there are remedies available under law. If there is a false case, the accused always has remedies to approach the High Court seeking quashing, or there are other orders passed. The matter may be pending before the court. So I think that via media has to be worked out. Perhaps, you know, it's not possible for me right now on your show to give you the modalities. This is something which the Parliament will have to introspect and come out with a blueprint as to how do you discern those cases which are politically motivated from those cases which are genuine and heinous. This is point number three. Point number four, let me say this on behalf of the Congress Party, that we will fully support the bill to decriminalize Indian politics. Let the government come out with a bill, let them table it in the Parliament. The Congress Party will wholeheartedly support this measure.
So,
a reality and a matter of fact born out of empirical evidence.
No, why? Because you're saying that, Adil, allow me this
interruption,
please.
Can I just complete my
please?
Point? I'll just take 30 seconds.
Okay, 30 seconds.
The ADR record, the ADR, the Association of Democratic Reforms, has come out with extensive case studies and analysis, which indicates that close to 107 BJP MPs in both houses of parliament out of 339, which is approximately 32%, face criminal charges. Similarly, when it comes to the BJP in the state legislatures, there are 451 BJP MLAs out of 1451, which comes to approximately again 32%, who face serious criminal charges. So this is something for the BJP to really introspect, because this is a party, and we've seen it in the past 4 years,
I will get a response from BJP
crime,
on that,
which endorses criminals record, and gives them patronage.
While
it
your
is
record
still,
may not be as glorious as that of BJP
no,
when it comes to criminal
record.
Netas.
This is available with the ADR.
I know that. And in the same table,
you can check up our record.
I am, allow me to, I am saying that, and I'm agreeing to the fact that it's not as glorious as the BJP. 15% of the MPs have declared criminal cases in your case, in the case of INC. 97 total MPs that they have analyzed is 97. Of them, 15 had declared criminal cases, of which 8 were serious criminal cases. That's 15. So why don't you get rid of these 8 people? Why are they still members
point.
Of Parliament?
Well, let's be very clear.
And what about the states?
Tanvi, I say this on behalf of the party. Let the BJP bring a bill and we'll fully support this bill. But you know, I'll tell you where is the chasm between the BJP's rhetoric and their
No,
delivery.
Mr. Boparai, the
when
fact
Abhishek
is not Krish, whether the BJP
the
brings
Chief
in the
Minister,
bill and you support
an
the bill. The fact is that if you genuinely want to clean up politics and decriminalize politics, you will not be giving tickets to such people.
We genuinely want
they
it,
don't,
but it's the
nobody
BJP which
wakes
is a majority.
Up overnight
when we come to power,
and
we
decides
will take
to turn into a criminal and have
measures.
10 cases against them. You join hands with people who, where the party chiefs themselves are convicted
then
you're
asking
of various
a party,
serious
you're
charges.
Asking a party
Your party
leader,
has gone into alliance
publicly
with other rival parties.
Any kind of protection to convicted MPs and MLAs.
Well,
we're a party which has
show
demonstrated
your commitment
we
when it comes to giving tickets. I'm
in
going to go across to other panelists. I will come back to you.
Us.
I'll
which,
come back to
which
you.
Honestly is not born from the empirical record. But Ajay Singh Bhish is the chief minister who's withdrawing heinous cases. He is asking his police to withdraw cases of murder, attempt to murder, rioting.
Let Aman Sinha join
UP
us and then
template.
let's get into
but
this aspect so that he gets to respond to
we will
you.
Support these measures.
Okay, you will support these measures because you know such a measure is never going to make it to the parliament. Let me go across to Pinky Anand. Good evening to you and thank you for joining us, Pinky Anand. Now, the big question is, what do we do? We really can't expect the politicians to bring about a law that will stop them from entering the parliament or the assembly. Then is the only solution fast-track courts to ensure that if there are pending cases, we get speedy justice and a result?
No, you're right. One of the solutions to the problems that are confronted because of the, you know, in particular context of the issue at hand, that is disqualification on ground of criminal charges or criminal convictions. Definitely, if the trials are speeded up and you have speedy fast-track courts with a time-bound period, you will have a solution coming out because there is a problem in this whole system. You have charges. No doubt charges are made after hearing the parties and prima facie finding. But at the same time, charges is not conviction. After charges, A, you can be discharged. After charges, the trial really has to start. Witnesses have to be examined. The case fully decided on the basis of evidence that is there before the court before there's a finding of conviction and acquittal. We also have a very high rate of acquittal and a very low rate of conviction. So at this, you know, when you see this entire scenario in front of you, you do have a rather complicated position to handle. So one of the solutions definitely is a fast trial court for particularly for political cases in the context of criminal cases.
Fast-track court is one solution that we could look at, but even in that case, we have statistics that suggest that they're not able to keep up. And the conviction rate, like Pinky Anand pointed out, is also extremely low. Professor Chokar, good evening. It seems like the voters will have to only depend on organizations like you.
Good evening.
To crunch the numbers, to dig out the data, and to show us the reality of every political party and our contestants.
You see, listening to the panelists so far, I am wondering where am I living? the information that the Supreme Court has said should be made available and which has been lauded by a lot of people has been available for 16 years. There was a Supreme Court judgment in 2002. I mean, some gentleman was taking us back to 2013. But if we go to 2002, the same Supreme Court, obviously a different bench, said that candidates contesting elections will have to declare on an affidavit under oath their criminal cases pending against them. And 22 political parties met in an all-party meeting and decided that they will not allow that to happen. An ordinance was issued to nullify the judgment. The ordinance was then converted into an amendment of the Representation of People Act unanimously in the parliament. And then we went to the Supreme Court again to say that that amendment of the Representation of People Act was unconstitutional. And mercifully, the Supreme Court in 2003 declared that amendment unconstitutional. Now, this is the history of where we are today. So this information which the Supreme Court has apparently so generously and so wisely asked political parties and candidates to declare, it is already being declared for the last 16 years, if you will. This is no big deal. I mean, Election Commission puts them on its website. All the media takes those affidavits. Your channel does it. All channels do it. All newspapers do it. We do it. So that information is available. It has not made any difference because all the candidates who have a serious chance of winning in elections are the same kind and the voters don't have a choice. This is number one. Number two, now this doctrine of separation of powers is of course absolutely right. But that doctrine of separation of powers also has a parallel doctrine called checks and balances. If the three pillars of the state do their jobs properly, there is no problem. But the doctrine of checks and balances says that if one of the pillars of the state somehow is not able to do or does not do what it is supposed to do, the other two pillars are supposed to compensate for that and balance it. Therefore, if the legislature or the parliament has not had time or not had inclination to make a law in this regard, there is a well-established principle of law that if there is a gap in legislation or there is an infirmity in the legislation and the legislature has not had time or inclination to do so and public interest is suffering, the judiciary has a right, actually a duty, to fill that gap or correct that infirmity till such time as the legislature does it. This is what was followed in the judgment in 2002. And as somebody had mentioned, it has been followed in various judgments, like in the Vishakha judgment.
Yes.
Now, Supreme Court can piously make a very strong and impassioned suggestion to the parliament. And it does not see that for 16 years, every political party has been involved. We have had governments of different persuasions. And Nobody has thought of it. As a matter of fact,
so I
when
take your
political
point.
Parties are required by the CIC to be public authorities under the RTI Act,
Professor Chandra, I take your point, and I will get a response from two of
and
our
the
experts
of the day,
in just a bit. But if I can just quickly also go across to Aman Sinha.
Just a minute. Let me add.
I'll come back to you, sir. I haven't had Aman Sinha make his opening remarks yet. And it's highly important that we also hear from the representative of the BJP because the Congress is putting the onus on the BJP to now bring in a law. Now, Mr. Sinha, good evening. Can we expect that to happen? Will your government, will your party bring in a law
good evening, Tanvi.
To clean up politics? Swachh politics kab milengi hame?
Tanvi, we welcome this judgment. It's a very fair, balanced judgment. And the directions which have been issued by the Honorable Court, they shall be complied with by the government. Whatever that it takes from the government side, we will ensure that it is done. And obviously, as far as lawmaking is concerned, it is entirely in Parliament's domain, as my learned friend Pinky G was also mentioning. And therefore, it is for Parliament to consider that. I am sure, since Supreme Court has made a recommendation, a suggestion, All the parliamentarians will consider it favorably and enact appropriately. As far as the directions in this judgment are concerned, Tanvi, they are very progressive, and as I was mentioning to you, that government will do its utmost to ensure that all the directions are implemented, whether it is giving complete information before the election commission, whether it is putting up all those election nomination forms on the party website, publishing them on the newspapers, etc. So whatever recommendations that the court has issued, they shall be complied with. And obviously, as far as lawmaking is concerned, there is a clear constitutional scheme. We have separation of powers. Lawmaking is squarely within the domain of the
right.
legislature,
so,
which is the union legislature, the parliament. And that apart, somebody was just making a point that there is a vacuum in on the statute book, but
yes,
clearly section 8, 9 and 10 of Representation of People Act stipulates all the disqualifications which are there. So there is no vacuum as such per se. However, whatever needs to be added, that will be added, and Parliament will consider it and appropriate additions.
I always have a tough time with the lawyers because they use words so brilliantly,
yes,
and turn them around. But what do you mean by you will do the Parliament will do whatever is favourable and appropriate?
We are learning from you, Tanvi.
What is favourable and appropriate in this specific scenario, Mr. Sinha?
Well, it is left to the wisdom of the parliamentarians. And I cannot speak for parliamentarians, Tanvi, as you can very well understand.
It
is left to them, all the political parties.
It's a very
they have
simple
to evolve
thing,
a consensus.
They are
the real stakeholders. But
let me say, Tanvi,
as far as electoral reforms are concerned, we have been voicing time and again that there needs to be substantive electoral reforms. We have been taking it up, whether these are electoral bonds, having simultaneous elections. However, support has not been forthcoming on many of these issues. And we would like to, that is one of our top priority areas, we would like to push all the electoral reforms forward.
No, so the Congress says that they are ready to pass, to support the bill if you bring it in. The question at hand is, anybody who faces a serious crime charge, you know, if it is a murder charge or a riot charge, a rioting charge, or a war against the nation or a serious rape charge, anybody who faces such charge and the case is going on, charges have been framed, charge sheet has been filed, should not be allowed to contest elections. Yes or no? That it's as simple as that.
Sorry, are you asking me that question, Tanvi?
Yes, that is to you.
That's a very legitimate and a valid view, Tanvi, that those who are indulging in serious, heinous crimes of, especially of moral turpitude, because the Supreme Court itself recorded in its judgment that there are several false cases also which are attributed and imposed upon those who are in public life. However, one should not run away from the fact that there are serious and heinous cases in which several people who are public representatives, they are involved in. And in those cases, there has to be a distinction, and therefore it is for Parliament to evolve a distinction. And in my assessment, in my personal opinion, Tanvi, the cases of moral turpitude, which you were just mentioning, and heinous crimes cases, there can be a distinction, and cases where there are, instances of political agitations, legitimate right to protest in a democratic republic, those cases could be distinguished, and therefore it has been left to the parliament. It would not be appropriate for me to prejudge and come to a conclusive kind of opinion on this. However, in my personal opinion, clearly, if there are heinous cases of rape, murder, in these cases there could be a distinction from cases such as arson, such as violation of public order, etc. So, therefore, it is for parliamentarians to evolve that distinction. I'm sure they are fully capable of doing
okay.
So, they will
so
do
let
it.
Me just highlight this, some Tell data me. That Adil was also referring to. Yes, coming to you next, Adil, just 1 minute. For BJP, total number of MPs that were analysed were 339. MPs with declared criminal cases, 107. That's about 32% of the elected representatives. 19% of them, which is 64 MPs, have serious declared criminal cases against them. Shiv Sena has about 21 MPs who were analysed. Of them, 18 have criminal cases against them. That's 86% of the elected representatives. half of them have serious criminal charges against them. Of course, the most glorious record probably goes to the RJD. And that works top-down in that party. And RJD has 9 elected MPs. Of them, 6 of them have serious charges against them. And the picture is completely different when it comes to the state assembly in Bihar. So then, Mr. Adil Bopar Rai, how do we clean up politics, empty assurances and nothing else that have happened in all of these years?
Well, Tanvi, like I said earlier, the Congress is committed to purifying the electoral stream and ensuring that criminal elements do not find a place in our political setup. And the government should bring a bill, we'll wholeheartedly support that. I say this at the cost of repetition. But you know, it's too much to expect from the BJP. And I'll tell you why. The track record of the BJP demonstrates that they have a chief minister in Uttar Pradesh who's facing serious charges of spreading enmity on the grounds of religion, of rioting, of attempt to murder, right. Who's an alleged history cheater. Mm. The BJP has rewarded such an individual with the high office of the chief minister of Uttar Pradesh. I think there is a lot for the BJP to explain. There is a huge chasm, like I pointed out earlier. We've had senior ministers of the government of India garlanding and felicitating convicted lynchers. I repeat, not those who are facing allegations, but convicted lynchers. Jayant Sinha and Giriraj Singh have publicly on camera garlanded convicted individuals. So where does
you
the BJP
are pointing
stand?
Out what
Sinha
is
Sahab had also spoken
the BJP
about electoral
doing? You're not giving me solutions here.
I like to
Adil,
point
do you
out,
have a solution? Do you have a solution? Just, what the Congress didn't do
well,
in all
those
years
when you were
in power.
Well, let us come to power and cleanse the system. That's the assurance. Well, it's another, well, Tanvi, it's another 6 months. We're coming to power and we'll cleanse the system. But let me point out another thing. Mr. Sinha spoke about electoral bonds. Let me tell you, the Election Commission of India is on record to state that electoral bonds actually ushers in opacity.
Yes.
You'll have a
electoral
situation of crony
is
capitalism.
A debate for another day.
You'll have crony capitalists
and
who favor
the
BJP,
I know even
funding
in that
the BJP
debate,
because anonymity
Tanvi.
Today is sure. going to be the dominant
But none of you,
narrative.
None of you raise this
no,
issue
these are all issues in, public
in the
domain.
Parliament. You had other important issues
this.
To create ruckus about in the budget session. Nobody wanted to create ruckus about electoral bonds because it may be benefiting
we
the BJP
the
today.
Issues of the people
it could
of
benefit
the, country,
the Congress
let us come
tomorrow.
To power next
Aman Sinha, 30
and
seconds to you, and
on.
Then I go to our other panelists. 30 seconds for Aman Sinha to rebut.
Yes, Tanvi. Well, Tanvi, I did not want to make it political, although now I have to mention that the Congress party has had the dubious distinction of getting their MPs, MLAs convicted for serious heinous crimes. And my friend was alluding to some charges on our representatives in Uttar Pradesh. Let me clarify and tell him that there are no such charges. And even if they are under challenge and they have not been convicted in any case at all. So therefore, there is a clear distinction. Here is a Congress party where their operatives have been convicted in cases of, heinous crime, serious charges of corruption. You will not find a single BJP functionary being convicted on either any charges of corruption or of any other heinous crime. Now, although I did not want, wish to make it political, but the fact of the matter is that whether it is a question of simultaneous polls, which saves lot of time, energy and resources of our country, the Congress party has opposed it.
Okay.
The issue of election bond, you are already seeing my friend from Congress party, he is opposing it.
But
and I think he was misquoting something when he said that some cases are being withdrawn. No cases are being withdrawn. There is a procedure under CRPC. If at all there is any case which is required to be withdrawn by the prosecution,
all right.
It has to be put up before the competent court and competent court takes a view on that.
All right,
and,
all right. So, I take your point. Let's move away from just BJP versus Congress on this issue.
Cases of rioting which are concerned, 20 biggest maximum casualty riots have taken place in the regime of Congress party.
Yeah.
I can go on and on,
you
but
can,
I do not wish
and
to
I agree with you because
the
it's the same for
all
political parties. So let me go across to our apolitical guests.
Work towards evolving a new legislation.
Mr. Kailash Vasudev, one interesting point that Professor Chokar raised earlier, and I want your view on this. Well, if one of the pillars of state, falls short in their in fulfilling their duties, it is the responsibility of the other pillar to stand up and fill the gap. Don't you think this could have been one of those cases where the Supreme Court could have perhaps looked at it Because let's be honest, we cannot expect this set of politicians or any other set of politicians that we've seen to bring about this change.
Look, you just told that in 2003 there was a similar order passed by the court. That was by a lesser bench of judges. Today, a much larger bench has decided it. We must get one perspective clear. Supreme Court will judicially review a situation. It will not judicially legislate. It is not its jurisdiction. For carrying out this kind of a change, which is very radical and far-reaching, there's the Representation of People Act, which governs elections and the entire electoral process. The amendments have to come in that act, especially in a whole plethora of sections over there, which lay down the criteria on which you can contest an election. Amendments have to come to the act through Parliament. Supreme Court is not going to amend an act. It does not have the jurisdiction. It is suggested to Parliament, please do it because things are getting out of hand. We are making the law that a person who does not have proper antecedents will not be allowed to not declare that and keep that as a disqualification. If a person doesn't disclose his antecedents, he can be disqualified at any given point of time.
Mm.
That in itself is a very, very big deterrent today. It was done earlier, but today the reiteration is different. The nomination forms will all have to mention this in block letters with all particulars of the case. It was not so very clearly mentioned earlier. So therefore, to say that the Supreme Court has failed, no, it has not failed. It's done its duty. It has done its judicial review. It's pointed out where the flaws are and says, please remedy them. The Supreme Court steps into areas to legislate. For example, Visakha is very largely mentioned of. Visakha came up as a very interesting case at a point of time where harassment at the workplace was being alleged by women, but there was no law. So they brought in the international conventions to read them into municipal laws, which is permissible. It has been done in a large number of cases where there is no legislation. The Supreme Court has suggested this is how we can go about it till such time as a law is not framed. But here there is a law which needs amendment, which needs to be looked at. That's what the Supreme Court says.
Okay.
So to say the Supreme Court is going to fill in a gap, it's not filling in a gap. It's telling the Parliament, look, do it. Things are out of hand.
No, but the other aspect is, Pinky Anand, that, yes, I take your point. And let me take it forward to you may come out and declare all your records and make it, and we can do our job by widely publicizing it, and, you know, and we do that. We did that even in the Karnataka elections. We held debates where we discussed in detail the criminal records or the cases against some of these candidates. But Pinky Anand, that doesn't help when all of your choices are equally colorful, are equally damning, because no political party choosing on the basis of... Yes, you get my question. Yes, go ahead, please.
I don't think, you know, in this entire discussion, one seems to find there are some preconceived notions and some judgment calls which are made. Be that as it may, what I'm saying is that, you know, it's decided that nobody has a choice and everybody is going to go only one way because of lack of choice. I don't think that's a fair surmise or a conjecture which can go that way, one. Secondly, we do seem to run into a principle of democracy. Do the people have a right to elect or they don't? Three, the judgment in question today actually deals in two parts. One is the right of people to know about the antecedents or criminal records of a candidate, or the political parties have to also publicize that, which is, I think, without any doubt, it has been taken count of, that right of people to know so that the people exercise their choice in the manner that they wish to is the point in question. And I think that judgment to that extent goes one way. The other part, which in fact the court has been very carefully kept away from, is the fact that the Representation of People's Act has a disqualification list on the basis of which you may disqualify a candidate. And the court has, aside from making a recommendation, not chosen to in any manner legislate, which I think is a clear indication and confirmation, in fact, of the separation of powers. Courts will not legislate. Yes, suggestions have been made to the parliament. The parliament may consider it. But for the timing, we do know that when you have a criminal conviction, which involves a punishment over a certain number of time, you are disqualified. That is the position as far as the parliament has so far chosen to do.
Yes.
In keeping with the spirit of democracy and other principles. Finally, I think let us get the record of criminal law also straight. Are we now going to say that if you are charged, you are guilty? Because if you are otherwise not entitled to stand or you're disqualified, then that means it will be done on the basis of a charge which might ultimately land into acquittal, it might land into a case not pursued, not pressed, and various other possibilities are there. So we really have to sit in a situation, if you look at this, when the last amendment was done, where conviction was made as a ground for disqualification, which hitherto was not there, that is why it went into this aspect and dealt with conviction being a ground for disqualification.
No, I agree with you.
And nothing less than that. For example, you can say when you start a criminal case, what about the stage when notice is given to somebody? Is that, does that mean that a person is guilty? And we do know there are a number of false cases which are filed against people, particularly in the political sphere.
No, I agree with you. Pinky Anand, that because and I completely believe in the system where you are innocent until proven guilty. But then I often also wonder that this is a different case. Yes, Mr. Upadhyay, I'm coming to you. And this is a different case because here you are electing them as our representatives to decide for us, to make policies, to make important decisions. You are putting them in a position of power as an MLA and an MP. And then they can even misuse that position of power for to derail the investigation, to put pressure, to intimidate and to threaten the witnesses in any case. Those also have to be kept in mind. Let's be honest about it. It happens in our country. And so how do you ensure that that doesn't happen? Which is why mostly in cases where there is a serious charge, we turn around and say an XYZ minister must step down until this case is over. You cannot be in a position of power while this case is on. So which is where my confusion really comes out from. Although I do believe that yes, we must have faith in that the definition that you are innocent until proven guilty. Ashwini Upadhyay, I wanted to come in. Go ahead, please.
You know, one thing.
देखिए, भारत में 122 करोड़ लोगों के पास आधार बन चुका है. 122 करोड़ लोगों का आधार बन गया. इसका मतलब 150 करोड़ भारत की पापुलेशन.
उपाध्याय जी, बस 30 सेकंड और दीजिए.
150 करोड़ की पापुलेशन में.
30 सेकंड और दीजिए, पिंकी आनंद जी. यस पिंकी आनंद को, प्लीज गो अहेड, प्लीज 30 सेकंड्स.
What I was just saying is this entire process that you talked about, a comparison about whether a minister should step down when a case is there because being in power. Firstly, at the present point of time, you're not talking about anybody but members of parliament or member of legislative assemblies, which is the issue in question. So the question of whether they should be there is representatives of people when people want them to be there, or should be disqualified because they have charges which have been initiated against them, however not concluded into a conviction,
right.
I think is a question that needs to be considered rather seriously. And to some extent, it was considered. It's been considered deeply. And that is why conviction itself was the only ground on which there could be disqualification and nothing less than conviction.
All right. All right. Yes, Mr. Upadhyay, go ahead, please. Sorry, I interrupted you.
Tanvi, Bharat mein 150 crore ki population hai. 122 करोड़ लोगों का आधार बन गया है. 20-25% लोगों के पास आज भी आधार नहीं, तो 150 करोड़ की पॉपुलेशन है. कोई भी पॉलिटिकल पार्टी 500 से ज़्यादा सीटों पर चुनाव नहीं लड़ती लोकसभा का. तो क्या 500 ऐसे लोगों को छांटना इतना मुश्किल काम है जिनके खिलाफ कोई केस ना हो? हम लोग लगातार उन्हीं की बात क्यों कर रहे हैं जिनके खिलाफ केसेज हैं? अरे 500 लोग छांटे जा सकते हैं इस 150 करोड़ की पॉपुलेशन से. इसलिए मेरा मानना है पार्लियामेंट कब इस पे कानून बनाएगी कब नहीं बनाएगी मैं नहीं जानता. ट्रिपल तलाक पे जैसे ऑर्डिनेंस आया है, ऐसे एक इस पे ऑर्डिनेंस लाना चाहिए. सुप्रीम कोर्ट के जजमेंट की स्पिरिट वही है, लोगों की डिमांड भी वही है. और मुझे लगता है ये अपकमिंग जो इलेक्शन है विधानसभा का, जो राजस्थान, मध्य प्रदेश और जो आने वाला लोकसभा का चुनाव है, उसको अगर हम पार्लियामेंट को देखेंगे, ये सारे चुनाव आगे बढ़ जाएंगे, फिर से लोग वही आ जाएंगे विधानसभा लोकसभा में. इसलिए इमीडिएटली एक ऑर्डिनेंस लाना चाहिए. ऑर्डिनेंस ला के ऐसे लोगों को तुरंत जो चुनाव की तैयारी कर रहे हैं उनको रोक देना चाहिए.
जी, ऑल राइट. कंप्लीटली रनिंग आउट ऑफ टाइम, सो आई एम गोइंग टू थैंक आवर पैनलिस्ट राइट नाउ. वी हैड अ फ्यू कॉलर्स. आई एम जस्ट गोइंग टू क्विकली रीड आउट व्हाट मिस्टर कमल ससोदिया वांटेड टू से. ही कॉल्ड फ्रॉम अहमदाबाद टू से डीक्रिमिनलाइजेशन ऑफ पॉलिटिक्स कैन ओनली हैपन व्हेन दोज इन पावर डिसाइड टू एलिमिनेट पॉलिटिशियंस विद क्रिमिनल चार्जेस अगेंस्ट देम. एंड आई डोंट नो ऑफ एनी पॉलिटिकल पार्टी हु एक्चुअली जेन्युइनली वांट्स टू डू दैट. मोहन कुमार सेड व्हेन इट इज अबाउट government jobs, they are very rigid and they take only those who qualify perfectly. Why don't they apply the same rules when it comes to jobs in politics? That's a fair question to ask. Decriminalization of politics can only happen clearly if the parliament now decides. or if we raise our voice to do that. We need to just start demanding accountability from our politicians. Relaxation in RTI rules, making accountability more difficult, lesser transparency in political funding with the bringing in of electoral bonds and so many other different changes in rules, and of course open field for criminals, all kinds of mafia in politics. Is this the Swachh politics that we really deserve? Is this the Swachh politics that a Swachh Bharat really deserves? When the politicians talk about cleaning up this country, why don't they begin with themselves? When the politicians talk about going after the money launderers and going after the corrupt, why don't they begin with themselves? When the politicians talk about bringing in tougher norms and rules and laws to fight crime against women, why don't they begin with themselves and ensure that they don't have such people in their parties and they do not give them any position of power? In Tamil Nadu, as we speak, a top minister who is now facing investigation, who was recently raided by the Income Tax Department in a scam, was elevated by his party. This is what happens in our country because there is no accountability. Should this be allowed to continue? I leave it for you to decide. You, the electorate, you, the voter, decide on that. Thank you so much for joining us tonight.